Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's my pleasure and privilege to be here today and to moderate our discussion, which is regarding the Ukrainian issues and not just only Ukraine. This is about the world order in the 21st century. First of all, let me thank the House of Europe and the Center for Geopolitical Studies for this brilliant initiative, because I think we really need broad and wide discussions, not just only Ukrainian issues, but other important issues in Georgia and around Georgia. So we have today three very well-known distinguished speakers. It's my pleasure to welcome Lilia Shevtsova, who is a non-resident fellow, Foreign Policy Program Center of the United States and Europe Brookings Institute. Mr. Vashadze, who is our former foreign minister, and you all know him, and Balázs, visiting scholar, Russia and Eurasia program, Carnegie Endowment for International Peace. So, world order in the 21st century and how the war in Ukraine affects in European security. Let me start with Lilia. My first question is, how do they see this process? Is it, so can we talk about the world order or world disorder and how it looks from Russia? How it looks from point of view of Kremlin politician and how the Russia society see this process? And could this process lead us to the new order, or it's create some zones of instability? Because Russian politicians, they prefer to talk about the spheres of influence, sphere of privilege, and so on. But it's like that we have more sphere and territories of instability, primers. So, and my question is, why Russia prefer to have pocket of uncontrolled territories over the friendship relation with the neighboring countries?
Well, first of all, I'm sorry that I'm going to stand. It takes some time. Firstly, why and how we view what's happening today in Moscow. There are several Moscows. If you ask the Kremlin representative, they would say, the West is encircling us. The West has been humiliating us. That's why Russia is responding. Russia, as you remember the movie, Russia is fighting or struggling or, you know, attacking, just, you know, responding back. This is one version. Another version will be, you know, my liberal Russian perspective. I'm in minority, kind of, you know, tiny minority, but I would say maybe between 15 and 17% of the Russian population would think like me, because up to 17% of the population support, you know, the liberal interpretation of the foreign policy. We would say that definitely the old post-communist order does not exist anymore. It's done with Putin's, you know, kicking over the global chessboard. It doesn't exist anymore. Let's already face the fact. But the issue, what triggered, is different. And the key reason why it happened, why there is no previous world order, is the fact that Russia, after nearly 20 years swimming, you know, in a new space after the collapse of the Soviet Union, cannot survive in the previous peaceful mode. The domestic resources for the Russian system of personalist power have been exhausted, no more. It's not because Putin is crazy or paranoidal or schizophrenic. No, not because of Putin, because of the system, stupid. The system cannot survive anymore in the peaceful mode. Hence, you know, the system and those who are serving the system have to use the foreign policy as the instrument to pursue the domestic agenda. Hence, Russia is turning towards the fortress Russia, turning to enemy search. And enemy search means military patriotic paradigm. And meaning also having enemies abroad in Ukraine, in Georgia, in Belarus, Moldova. Let's look further, and of course, United States as the arch enemy. So it's our domestic imperative that the Kremlin is trying to pursue, which explains what Kremlin is doing on the foreign policy field. So Ukraine is only the result, only one result.
What do you think? What's the current world order? And how Europeans see the development in Ukraine? Actually, is this the crisis in Ukraine, or what is your assessment? Crisis around Ukraine? I remember many definitions regarding the eastern neighboring country. Even today, some of experts and politicians would prefer to talk about some kind of buffer zones, about the ring of fire and so on. So what is Ukraine right now? What is the world order? And how do you see the neighboring countries between the EU and Russia?
Well, first of all, thank you so much for inviting me. It's really a pleasure to return to Tbilisi. I've been here before the Rose Revolution and keep coming back, thanks God, quite regularly, although I haven't been here for over 2 years. And within such a distinguished panel, I really an honor to be here. Second, let me continue with my agreement with Lilia on that this is a systematic issue, a system issue, if you like. We all, you know, when we see what's happening in Donbas and annexation of Crimea, we tend to forget how this is started in Ukraine, and that was essentially a crisis which brought down the central authority along with Yanukovych, and that central authority was essentially the post-Soviet Ukraine. You know, the corrupt, rent-seeking, oligarchic Ukraine, and this is something why? Because of huge inequality, because of growing civil society, because of the rent-seeking, and the political polarization with it, right? And when you take a look around, this is essentially very similar, for example, in the situation with Russia. Everywhere in the former Soviet Union, and essentially in Western Europe as well, you can see, or in the West, it's the degradation of traditional institutions. Now, if you put, you know, into an end of resources, as at least we used to have. So, you know, the Ukraine situation is, and then, you know, after the Maidan, all sides are kind of reacting on that. We see essentially a very, I would even call it foolish reaction of Russia to annex Crimea. And, you know, like, I always kind of explaining this because, particularly in the United States, they used to write about the chess game, you know, Putin is winning in a chess game. And I always think about that. You don't pull out the gun in a chess game when you're winning. You pull out the gun in a chess game when you feel that you have nothing else to lose. And so the reaction of Russia, the annexation of Crimea, was much more out of an outcry. It doesn't justify it, but it was not, in my reading, it was a clear, pure reaction on the fears which were connected with the Maidan and the fears what exactly that would mean for Russia. The other important thing is like putting into a kind of a broader context, and then I'm going to move to how it influences Europe, is, you know, the essential fragmentation of power everywhere, which a lot of scholars, philosophers are writing about, you know, but we see essentially that this is not, you know, this is the Maidan and the Ukrainian crisis is not because of Russia or because of a CIA coup, right? But this is a clashes of local, this is a local development. And even when you see the situation in Donbas, you know, and the obvious support of Russia and Russia's presence in the Donbas, the local actors are still kind of influential. The same you can say about the Western Ukraine relationships. Sometimes it's hard to say whether these are the rebels who are moving Russia or the Russia who are moving with the rebels. I think it's vice versa. This is a symbiosis. It's also very hard sometimes to see whether Ukraine is moving with the West or the West is moving with Ukraine. It's also a kind of interesting symbiosis, which, you know, the details kind of determine who is having the stronger card. Now, the third is Europe, and, you know, it's a kind of interesting circle, but I see that, you know, 10, 15 years ago, there was the Russia first policy, right? Then the Eastern Partnership came, which finally put the region first, And at the same time, the Russian-EU or European relationship were going down. And now we kind of have still the Russia again first, but it's more like punish Russia first type of thing because of the Ukrainian crisis. I think the Ukrainian crisis, clearly for everyone, although it's a very decisive, very divisive issue still for Europeans, and I think we shouldn't underestimate this issue, everybody would agree that what Russia does in Donbas, and it's particularly in the annexation of Crimea, is something unacceptable. At something Russia need to be paying a price.
May I ask you, just imagine, that tomorrow Russia really stop his aggression against Ukraine. And, I mean, situation in Donbas will be much better, and they start some kind of cooperation with the central government and so on. How do you think? Is West ready still push Russia on Crimea issues, or it will be enough?
I don't think that there is such an agreement, or it would be such an agreement. The most important thing that the Minsk agreement implementation is essentially halted. You know, there is a neither war nor peace situation now between Ukraine and Russia, or I mean in around the Donbas, and particularly Germany is very much pushing now both sides, both Russia and Ukraine, to move with the implementation. But Russia, you know, is accusing Ukraine for stopping the political process, and Ukraine is saying, you know, the number one issue here is withdrawing the soldiers and the troops, which Russia clearly not complying with. So this is a kind of, you know, neither war nor peace situation. I don't want to call it, it's a total collapse of the Minsk agreement, simply because there are still negotiations going on. There are still, you know, the escalations or the fighting are very much limited in around 2-3 places, you know, so it's not a total collapse of the ceasefire or the Minsk agreements, but we see this neither war nor peace situation. And I think it's very important to understand one thing, that so far I don't see that Germany or anyone else would like to return to a business as usual with Russia. I think there's a large understanding that Russia, whether because it's strong or whether this is because it's weak, but certainly is a risk for Europe, and the Ukrainian crisis is taken as a risk, which, you know, Europe so far has no answer, simply because Russia pulled out the gun, and that's something which Europe neither can match at this stage nor wants to match at this stage.
Okay, one more question. As we are talking about the European security and the world order, how do you think? Is the West united when we are talking about the Russia's policy, or they are united just then we are talking about the Crimea or even Lugansk or Donbas? So my question is that is the West ready to talk not about the case-to-case issues, but about the unacceptance of the such kind of policy? Then the one country thinks that he has some kind of special rights, and this territory is his sphere of influence, and he can change order and situation, including by the military issues. So it's where, for instance, 2014, when this aggression started against Ukraine, it was exactly 20th anniversary of the signing very famous Budapest Agreement, when the country who had nuclear weapon disarmed itself and had very strong guarantees from the UK, United States, from the Russia, and one of the country, one of the guarantor, violated territorial integrity of this country.
I think the current situation isn't there is a leg. I don't want to go into the debate what exactly was signed and how, but there's several interpretation of the Budapest Memorandum. I think you know, those who are signed obviously should help Ukraine more, right? But at the current situation, they can't. There is again no capacity and no necessary resources immediately available over or not, and particularly there is no democratic mandate for the governments to do so. You know, you need to explain for your population that we're going into war with Russia because we signed in 1994 an agreement in Budapest that we guarantee security of Ukraine. And that is something, you know, the democratic mandate, which is very much missing, beyond the necessary immediately available resources. Just think about, you know, that for NATO going into war with Russia, this is a serious undertaking. It's not just, you know, sending two ships and that's it. So you know, these are a lot of implications. What you can see that there is a reemergence of NATO importance and restructuring of the NATO, because we also have to see that NATO was not able, capable to react. The mechanisms which supposed to work immediately, they did not. So this kind of reemergence and reinvigoration of NATO, which is clearly going on, and now there are more and more, you know, serious undertaking of building up capacity of the border of NATO vis-a-vis Russia. You know, it's now the United States is sending heavy weapons, and you know, and there's a lot of reassurance that Article 5 is gonna, you know, taken live. You know, also I think we have to distinguish between the Budapest Memorandum and NATO Article 5. These two things are not the same. And here comes the democratic mandate that explaining to people that we're going into war over Ukraine because of the Budapest Memorandum is complicated.
Thank you. Thank you, Balázs. And let me ask to Kia Vashadze, our former foreign minister, who actually knows very well Russia. He knows quite well Russian diplomacy. He knows and he remember our experience in 2008. So we are talking today that 2014 is the prolongation of 2008. Yeah. So actually I heard also that this start in very beginning of the 90s when some kind of hybrid war we had here in Georgia. In 2008, I remember concerns, including our partners and strategic partners, about some kind of decision of the Georgian leadership. I think, the question was that, was this war avoidable or not? I think today, after Ukrainian issues, it's clear. But my question is that 2008, I remember the meetings follow to this aggression, and it was right, this is alarm call for Europeans, and we have to strengthen our prevention mechanism and so on, so on. And exactly the same wording I heard in 2014. So do you think is the really final last call, wake-up call, or this is just that we are ready to frozen with conflict and do business with Russia as we had before?
Lilia gave a wonderful example, you know. I would like to greet ladies and gentlemen present here. Now, thank you for including me into this distinguished panel, first of all. And I would like to stress and note that I'm a private citizen. I'm not a member of any committee, any council. I don't have obligation to spread literacy or illiteracy. I'm absolutely free in my judgment, and if some assessments are too harsh, please excuse me for that, because, again, I'm here a private citizen. To start with, I would like to 150% share Lilia's notion about systematic crisis in Russia, and those in a very good Marxist way to stress that crisis is not coming because of actions, actions are coming because of crisis. We are looking at something which tectonically changed the world. This is not the world we knew, and it's never going to be again. We are in the beginning of very marked future. We don't know what this future is going to be like, but we shall be prepared for it. And being optimists, hopefully, we shall be very pessimistic when it comes to our perspectives, when it comes to Georgia, first of all. When we assess our situation as one of the independent post-Soviet countries, we shall, the whole Georgian diplomacy, if there is left anything out of Georgian diplomacy. They shall be boarding the goddamn planes right now, flying each and every European capital, NATO capital, United States capital, our allies capital in Far East, Japan, Australia, New Zealand, and telling to them that, ladies and gentlemen, either we are going to survive as an international community, or we are going down individually as a sovereign states. If the West, NATO, the European Union, West in a broad political sense, meaning, excuse me, of this word, will not, shall not, and ought not understand this simple truth, we are all gone. Georgia is surrounded by at least 35 active or sleeping conflicts right now. We are talking about Ukraine, and Tengo is absolutely right. Whoever, and I have my distinguished colleague sitting here in this house, Gegam Galublishvili, who was our ambassador to Turkey and playing the crucial role in those dark days of 2008. Mamuka Kudava, exactly the same, our former ambassador in France. Guys, I have to tell you that 2008 didn't wake up the West, didn't teach any lesson to anybody, including Georgia, and basically left no trace other than occupation of Abkhazia and Skin Valley region. Then we've been slipping, all sanctions being removed in 6 months, business as usual again. Putin was keenly answering requests of Madam Chancellor and other Western leaders and buying shipyards and saving some production places, like he has done with Kiel shipyard in Germany, saving 26,000 working places to Madame Merkel. So everybody was perfectly happy. Georgia was getting notice, guys, you shall be lower than grass and quieter than fish, and you know, the future will show. Today, we are looking at the worst breach of international law we could possibly have seen after the Second World War. The United States and the United Kingdom being the guarantees of the agreement of Budapest Protocol simply ignored it. Okay, this is not the first time. We remember that, yes? But the most amazing thing is that with $700 billion USD spent on intelligence, not a single goddamn operative sent a cable to one's capital telling to them that very polite green people suddenly emerged out from nowhere in Crimea in December of 2014. Excuse me, 13. And nobody dared, and nobody cared to ask a question, what we are doing. Why we are doing this, staying still, not asking questions to Russians, and why Russians are doing this. Tengo's question is a legitimate one. Georgians are not angels with wings, I can tell you that. We made our share of mistakes, but war of 2008 was absolutely unavoidable. Because Putin nearly got a heart attack nearly died of high blood pressure when he heard the wording, Ukraine, Georgia and Ukraine will become members of NATO. This poor KGB major thought that we are entering the NATO right now, that in September during the ministerial, Georgia is going to get MEP. So the question about the war was decided. On April 16th, the Russian ambassador came to me and said, "No, you know, everybody who works at the Ministry for Foreign Affairs, they think about my humble self as their classmate, which is true." So he delivered the message from Russia that all problems, all questions, everything concerning Georgia was transferred from the Ministry for Foreign Affairs to the General Staff of the Russian Army. It was repeated again on that terrible night of August 7. The war was unavoidable, and we had a very, very difficult choice to let 60,000 Georgians being killed or to show the resistance. No, it's up to Georgian people to decide what was the correct. But Yanukovych opted for just another solution. He had 14-point list rolled down by Russians, which he immediately executed without asking anything in return till July the 4th of 2010, including neutral status of Ukraine and firm refusal to ever join NATO, read any political military organization, the prolongation of Sevastopol military naval base for Russia, Balaklava submarine naval base, golden share in nearly six major military Ukrainian contractors. He has done all this. What he got instead? Pardon my Russian, I'll switch to Russian. Когда он приехал в Москву, он попросил, что, ребята, как газ? А ему сказали, газ – это другой вопрос. Да, газ – это бог и отдельно, котлеты отдельно. And he got Maidan. Now, I'm a Georgian citizen, I'm a Georgian diplomat, I'm a former Russian diplomat, Soviet diplomat, excuse me, I've never been Russian diplomat. I'm looking at my country right now, I am scared to death. And we all shall be scared to death, because we are not prepared for any challenge. We have the government, guys, right now in Georgia, which is stubborn as a Mississippi mule and with the same amount of intellect. These guys are telling to us that country is run perfectly well, everything is under control, and then we are getting innocent mountain river coming out from one's own way, and it's a national disaster. Just think about 35 active or sleeping conflicts we're getting around us. Bring here Madame Khidasheli and ask her one simple question. Do you sincerely think that 30,000 professional army, which has just nearly half of the active soldiers as a part of the fighting force, close to 15,000. Do you sincerely think that right now, today, it's enough to defend Georgia? We shall get back to what George Marshall used to call to citizen army, if we want to defend this country. Trust me, Russian bus or train, whatever it is, hasn't stopped, and they do not have any plans to stop. Putin is not playing chess. Shandor is absolutely right. Putin is playing poker. And he knows Europeans very well. He despises them wholeheartedly, quite justly at a certain point. He despises them, and he knows that NATO, going to war with NATO, of course NATO is never going to start war with Russia. But what is the problem of supplying defensive weapon systems to Ukraine? Is here anybody who can bring one sound, lucid argument to me? What is the problem? You cannot. To finalize my outburst, I should say, let me tell you that I'm old enough to remember last years of Carter presidency, when the United States were very weak and Europe was even weaker. I'm looking at something quite close to that right now. And the hope is that in 2016, with changes in Washington, D.C., we will see quite different political West, which understands that if you are not going to fight, you are going to be defeated. It's as simple as it gets. Thank you.
Lilia, now, how do you think? Is it a one-man show, or this is the system problem? Because if we imagine that tomorrow you have actually election next year, yeah? So if tomorrow Putin replaced, will the system change? When 70% population support policy like today Russia has regarding the Ukraine, or is it also a mistake? It's not 70%, it's just the Kremlin polls. How do you think?
We have a faction of those who are standing up. Tengiz, there are some questions that you raised that apparently have no certain answer. I would say, first of all, that I totally share, Minister, your scare. But not only because the system of international governance is not working, not because the West has not been prepared for this drama, but because Mr. Putin, and I'm coming to your question, apparently having annexed Crimea, has no, absolutely neither energy, guts, imagination, or any kind of assuredness as to what to do next. He is in a bobsled mode, okay? You can regulate the bob, you cannot jump out of that. So, and there is a great, you know, inevitability about the whole drama. And now about your question, very firstly. I, at the moment, being, you know, very respected, old, representing older generation of Putinologists, I would say, shit, you know, it's not about Putin anymore. Change of the regime will be probably one of the ways to reproduce the system. This is firstly. And at the same time, the change of the regime, which is coming, folks. Well, I'm not going to make bets for Kings Maroli. This is my favorite still. But, you know, 2 years from now, I would never bet that he's still in the Kremlin. Why? Because for the first time in the Russian history, we have the Russian rent-seeking elite that have been personally incorporated into the West. We never had it before. Those guys are living in the West. They have kids in the West. They have banks in the West. They are part of London grad. They belong to the West. This is the most pro-Western Russian elite we ever had. Only they want to insulate the Russian society from the West. But at the moment, they stopped to look at Putin as the guarantee of their well-being. Of course, you know, they are not going to rebel to revolt at the moment because it's not the time yet. But they do believe that this 89% that you mentioned, 89% of approval rating, it's skyrocketing approval rating. This is also bullshit, because they all remember the Communist Party of the Soviet Union, 6 months before it collapsed, it had the rating of approval 99.9%, okay? So the higher you have, maybe pretty soon you'll have 140% of approval rating. Okay, we are moving to that height, which means we cannot trust it. But what does it mean if Putin is leaving political scene? Because, well, usually, you know, the Russian leaders are leaving the Kremlin only in two cases. When they die by themselves, or when they are killed without wishing to be in the cemetery. So we don't know how he will leave. And any kind of personality around his group will come, because apparently those who are closer to the buttons will take the power. But even in this case, any change creates a possibility of option. Any change creates some window of opportunity. Any change opens, if not the door, but the window. So it will be a kind of a progress. But you folks have to be prepared also for this option. Change of the regime, firstly. You have to think about that. Secondly, you have to think that the elite does not want it anymore. Does not want it anymore. And secondly, you have to think about the society. At the moment, society that voted for Putin, I don't know whether they voted really or not, but society who allegedly, you know, have this 89% of approval rating, they don't care about Putin. They do care about their freezers. And very soon, after watching TV, they will start to look into their freezers, and they will understand what means the first, you know, half of this year, which means 40% of the GDP we lost. 40% of GDP. Can you imagine? And the military drug is wearing off, okay? Because only 25% of Russians would like their army to fight with Ukraine, only 25%. So it's totally new country. Simply, they are demoralized, they are dragged. You know, they've been injected. But, you know, I know other nations, very civilized, very cultural, very dignified in the 20th century, who also had been injected and committed atrocities and went through tragedies. So we are not alone in this suicidal path. But at the same time, we have a great hope. Russians are subject of consumption. They're consumption agents. Simply, you know, they have to turn from TV to their freezers, and they will turn pretty soon.
Thank you, Lilia. And I would like... thank you for hope. And as we are talking about the security, let me ask you one more question. Today, often when even we are talking in Georgia about the NATO, about the occupied territory, we are talking about our national interests. The rhetoric we are heard from Russian politicians, they are also talking from their national interests. So my question is, taking consideration the situation you just described, is the national interests which are carried out by the Russian politicians are really interest of Russian nation?
You know the answer. At the moment, the Kremlin allegedly demonstrates the so-called quote-unquote national interests that are interests not even of the rent-seeking elite anymore. Because as I've mentioned, the rent-seeking elite with Mr. Usmanov, with Mr. Abramovich, the two guys on the Forbes list of the UK residents, they want open windows. You know, they don't want isolation. They don't want Russia being kicked out of the G8. You know, they don't want Russia to be a scapegoat, a kind of leper walking on the international scene and trying to embrace China. They don't want it. So far, the national interests already are becoming allegedly something, you know, as a kind of interest of survival of a very narrow group of people. Mr. President, and maybe someone around the president, but when I'm looking at the chairman of Gazprom, at the chairman of Rosneft, at the chairman, you know, of all other these proms, nefts, oil, gas, whatever, that they need dual technology, Western money, refinancing, that they have to pay back $150 billion just now. Of course, you know, their national interest is not to have war with Georgia, is not to have war with Ukraine, is not to have, you know, Americans like, you know, Obama and whatever, and Merkel as enemies. No, not at all. So the notion of the official national interest is shrinking to the one notion, you know, the way how one guy apparently is surviving. And this is a tragedy, yes? And we are paying in Russia for that. You paid in 2008, I totally agree with you. It was a rehearsal. Well, probably it was inevitable, but it was a rehearsal of Ukraine. And Ukrainians are paying for that. Ukrainians are paying with their blood.
Thank you. Balázs, it's like we have conflict of values. How ready is Europe to defend its value, to one point? And another question is, when we are talking about the Europe and where we are talking about the European security, what does it mean? Does it mean security of the EU, or it means security of Europe? Because if we are talking about the security of Europe, Europe means the EU plus other European countries.
Thank you. I do think that we have a kind of a clashes of values as well, or value systems, certainly. And certain values that Putin represents, or trying to represent, or rhetorically represent, it's a big question, is kind of resembling certain European leaders, right? You know, it's a kind of conservatism I call traditionalism, which, you know, like it can unite Putin, Lukashenko, Orban, and part of the far right, not all of them, you know, certainly. But I think what really connects these people, that they're out of control within their own constituencies for so long time, just as Putin, Lukashenko, and Orban, in their own political context or political societies, polities, right, for out of real competition and real contact, the check and balances do not work. So it's essentially the weak democratic institutions or weak democratic systems which allowing this kind of polities or this kind of controls over polities to flourish. Now, how much when it comes to defend, right? And also in many ways, like, you know, I don't want to go into the question of Russian propaganda because, you know, it's a whole new different topics, but there are certain issues which is like the conservative issues or value issues, which kind of reflecting differently or resonating differently in the mainstream media. I'm sorry, in the mainstream public in Europe. For example, the question of gay marriages, right? Which a lot of Europeans feel that kind of Europe and the mainstream media is running a little bit too far with this. And you know, we would need a bit more time to do that. This is not my opinion, but this is essentially the mainstream opinion in Slovakia. It's a mainstream opinion pretty much everywhere in Central and Eastern Europe, right? That, you know, and we are kind of a new, I'm from Slovakia originally, you know, we are new members of the European Union, and kind of my people, citizens, fellow citizens feel in the way. Again, I don't necessarily, but this is what I'm here at home, and you know, even from my friends. And this is where, for example, the Russians are tapping into this kind of value category, which in the end is a kind of divisive, right, within the European solidarity or European society. When it comes to defense, like security, right, the issue I think is very much different, because again, the annexation of Crimea and war in Europe is unacceptable for the Europeans. This is not how we want to live our life. There was, after the Second World War, there was a clear consensus, you know, and we thought that this is a shared consensus, and seeing Russia being in a situation that solving issues, political issues with weapons, it's unacceptable, certainly for Europe. So what we're going to see, or what we see already, is, you know, and also, like, it's very important to understand that if you put the entire East Europe, the Eastern Partnership, and Russia in the Western capacity, political policy capacity, in the context, then, you know, we're dealing with essentially a degradation on the Western institution side. You know, Lilia can say how many American experts on Russia you know, right? Up to 10, perhaps. Who would know what's going on? Like, how many military attachés were in the U.S. embassy in Kiev during the Maidan? It was one. So much about the CIA coup, right? I mean, the U.S. stopped following, and the Europeans just building up the capacity. The Eastern Partnership is 9 years old, right? I remember 9 years ago, we trying to find a desk officer for Belarus in the European Commission. We couldn't find one. You know, so if you put, these capacities are actually like kind of rebuilding and coming back. So the understanding, the level of information, the sophistication of the analysis are improving since then. So, you know, and this is a kind of, like, we were missing that. Like, we were mentioning, you know, like, simply nobody was watching these kind of things because it was coming from us out of the blue, the whole conflict, right? And because our capacity were low and our understanding was lower or were lowering in the past 20 years. Simply Russia wasn't risk. It wasn't a risk factor. So, you know, it is, if you put that into the context of 1 year only, you know, there is this rebound now is happening. But for example, very importantly, and I already mentioned this, that Ukraine is a divisive factor. Look at the polls in Poland. The majority of Poland would not agree to provide weapons to Ukraine. The majority of the Poles would not agree to provide financial support for the Ukrainians. Yet the majority of the Poland think, vast majority, that Ukraine needs help and Russia needs to be punished. Now put that these factors together, if you are running a democratic country and you are essentially dependent on what the public thinks. So, you know, so when and I think it's dangerous to portray what's going on in Ukraine, therefore, as black and white. As the evil and the good, right? Because what, and this is again, one very much agree with Lilia, the system can't reproduce itself. In Ukraine, what we see, unfortunately, is the old system reproducing itself. It's just now, the big commodity which they're selling is the conflict with Russia. You know, essentially what you see in Ukraine, and I'm very unfortunate to say that, but this is how, as far as I see, they're trying to change the rent giver, the Ukrainian oligarchic elite, the rent giver, from Russia to the West. And this is what the West cannot accept. And this is where there is a growing kind of, you know, the Ukraine issue, there's a growing anticipation what they see in Kyiv. And therefore, the West is going to put now pressure not only on Russia, but on Ukraine as well to kind of find an end of this conflict.
If I may. You know, I would agree with my friend Balázs on many things, but I do believe that I need to be here much more romantic or maybe idealistic regarding Ukraine. You know, my every month, 2 weeks in Ukraine proves that you are absolutely right. The Ukrainian elite is not up to the task in many areas. They wasted so much time, regretfully. They wasted nearly 1 year. And you know, it's painful for me and for other friends to see their squabbles, their, well, not the oligarchics bickering, but simply, you know, lack of strategic vision on many things and lack of readiness to do reforms, especially corruption, anti-corruption struggle. But at the same time, I see there what I haven't seen in any country that I lived or visited. I spent, you know, the best years of my life in Poland watching solidarity from the birth in Gdańsk to victory. But I've never seen it even in Poland, neither in Hungary, nor in any Eastern European country, when the society can replace the state that does not function. This is the world's unique case. Ukrainians did it. The state, especially last year, didn't function at all. Now it has started to do different functions. It couldn't resist Russia, neither separatist or whatever you can call them. So society started to wage the war. Volunteers and battalions and, you know, self-assistance, etc. So Maidan, it's a self-regulated horizontal structure that has no analogies in the world history. And so my hope is with the fact that this society can help the Ukrainian elite to wait for these 5 years until the moment it has to be changed. Simply, you know, this elite feels the pause. And I'm very optimistic about Saakashvili. A lot of my friends say, oh, this Georgian came to Odessa, you know, oh, what the hell he's going to do there?
They said the same thing.
You know, I am glad that he came. A lot of Odessa people, I was in Odessa 2 weeks ago, they're happy because, well, not because, you know, he has this reputation in Georgia, but because they have a new face, new team, not connected to old, corrupted, you know, iron networks. So, and I have a great hope that he could show something, a breakthrough, break the window, break the China. It would be good for Odessa.
I hope as well, and I agree that society, yeah, is really very important, but any society needs support and need help. And talking about, you mentioned already Russian propaganda, so you know what is interesting, that before the most popular message from Russian propaganda, it was that Russian or Eurasian values are more familiar for Georgians or for others, where for instance Eastern values. Now they change actually message and develop another message. This is that they are not talking about the are they better or worst. The point is that geography matters, and guys, relax, you are in our sphere of influence, and actually West today talking more, but look at reality. You are where you are, and you are abundant. Yeah, maybe the maximum you will reach this is visa liberalization, and that's all. So my question goes to Gia Vashadze. What we can do? How we can act in this situation? Not just react, but be proactive. Because what I see, not just in Georgia, but also our Western friends, they are more reacting when acting. So what we can do to be more proactive, and how we can explain that, yes, geography matters, but Georgian geography, this is Europe. And the security of Georgia, it means the security of EU. And that security of Ukraine, Georgia, the Black Sea region, because we all are European nations. And if we look through the European history, European culture, we contribute a lot. And even today, we are contributing to secure the Europe.
Tengo, thank you very much. I would like to add a small commentary to Balázs' statement. You know, I am not a politologist, I'm a lawyer. When your neighbor is robbed, raped, and killed, you are not asking questions about his democratic credentials. You pick up the damn phone and call the sheriff. If there is no sheriff, you try to help him. Now, this is not a valid, sound, and lucid argument for me. Ukrainians are not good, they are replicating corruption. Excuse me, do we want to have international law or not? If we do not want to have international law, then everything is perfectly all right. Member of the Security Council of the United Nations can seize 26,000 square kilometers from another member of the United Nations. Then everything is perfectly all right. We live in a wonderful, rosy world. If we have international law, then it's a totally different question. We shall use Charter of United Nations nobody wants to speak about to help Ukraine defend oneself with all legal means, full stop. And after Ukraine's sovereignty, territorial integrity, and independence is saved, let's sit down at the Euro Parliament or elsewhere where these guys are getting 300,000 euros a year for God knows what, measuring cucumbers, and let's then start talking about Georgia's, Ukraine's, or any other country's democratic credentials. Otherwise, one day, not Russia, but maybe ISIS will knock on the door of one of our highly estimated, respected, and beloved allies, and they will not have enough will, preparedness, material, or moral resources to defend oneself. We are speaking about Russia as if Russia is the only danger we are looking at, guys. We are 1 hour and 30 minutes airplane flight from military or civilian from ISIS occupied territory. What the hell we're speaking about? We are looking at Kurds starting war very soon in Iraq because they're in Iraq because they are sick and tired of Qatar, Saudis, and intelligence sources and newspapers claim, Turkey providing help to ISIS. We're looking at a war which is going soon to start another front in Syria. Everybody united against Bashar Assad. Now you got some, not you, excuse me, but we got something. Where Bashar looks like Mother Teresa. And nobody has, excuse me, ladies, balls to fly down to Damascus and then to Tehran to sit down and to create a united front against something which is the biggest peril to our civilization. And when IGIL will come to certain capitals, trust me, gay couples will be killed together with heterosexual ones. They are definitely not going to start differing them. What Georgia shall be doing right now? Tengo, now I shall express my sympathy to Tengiz, which happens to be on this government, but is quite different from the bigger part of these people. We shall understand simple thing. Nobody is going to help Georgia if we are not helping ourselves first. Nobody is going to defend us if we're not able to defend ourselves. We do not have agriculture, for God's sakes. We do not have it. Let's get that legislation and meticulously observe rules, regulations of the European Union. Is it an example? Yes, it is. Let us start creating a real army. Guys, 30,000 boys, God bless them. They all are heroes. They did fight like lions in 2008. And Russian army actually experienced what is the trouble when Georgians are fighting. But it's simply not enough. It's simply not enough. We have to have citizen army. It shall be clearly understood. Everybody's duty is to defend one own country. Third, economy. Look at our economy. we have the stupidest government anywhere, 6,000 miles around, yes? And these guys are talking about budget, balancing budget. And they want to balance budget moving funds from one ministry to another. They have taken out 140 million lari from education, and they took it to infrastructure, and they tell it to us that they are balancing the budget right now. Why business, first of all, why Georgian taxpayer, and second, why Georgian business shall be always be responsible for economic crisis? Why bureaucracy is never responsible? Our very good friends and allies, Baltic Republics, in 2008, right in the middle of very difficult financial crisis, they've cut their civil service for 35%, and those who did stay in, their salaries were cut by another 25%, and now these countries are financially healthy. We are lying to ourselves. Garibashvili and his government is robbing us and our kids, and the next government will get a total disaster on their hands. So is there a plan of action? Yes, there is a plan of action. We all know what we have to do. Civil rights, independent court, human rights, free market where every investor, Georgian, because we're always speaking about foreign investors, as if Georgian is not an investor. Georgian and foreign alike do understand what are the rules of the game, which are not going to change, because Bidzina's carrot juice was not sweet enough at 10 p.m. It is as simple as it is. And to finish the whole thing, guys, let's remember one thing. When we're talking about Russia, we are speaking about, I like to say sometimes that I'm more Russian than Georgian, 40 years, you know. I'm like double-faced Janus. if you speak about Russian state, you speak about Russians, you shall remember one thing. We're speaking about shrewd, intelligent, apt, and easily adjustable adversary, which shall always be respected. Maybe never feared, but very much respected. To finish this second outburst, when we did mention 2008, who does know why Russians actually started this war on August the 7th? You know. Everybody speaks about Beijing Olympics. It's nonsense. No. The reason was that Russians been closely monitoring the situation with the American financial crisis. And they know that on August the 7th, the White House and Paul Hansen, Treasury Secretary of the United States, shall take decision about Lehman Brothers. The whole American establishment was consumed with this question, because everybody knew if Hank lets the Lehman Brothers disappear, it means that we are guys officially in a brown substance without a pedal. And then no Georgia is a matter. So respect Russians, trust me, and don't expect that they are going to fall apart anytime soon. They will be terrorizing us for many years to come. And Lilia is absolutely right. No, please don't. I'm very sorry, but if Putin is gone, trust me, the next guy there will be exactly like him, because this country, which is 17 and a half million square kilometers, with just 150 million of inhabitants, think about this, of arithmetics, country which is tremendously rich with everything, which has paranoia about one's own past, present, and future, and which does not have an ideology. The only ideology which can hold this country and nation together is nationalism. Hence, systematic replication of what Lilia just mentioned about. Thank you.
Thank you, yeah. So let me now open the floor for the questions. Sure. So please introduce yourself and the name speaker. The question is going. So please, Mamka.
Mamukakudava, I belong to the same organization as the minister, but he's too radical for me, so that you know, yeah. Yeah. But seriously speaking, I have a question to Lilia Shevtsova. When she said, when you said about two Russias, it happens that this quote is on my desktop as well. Алексей Толстой, есть две Руси. Знаете, первая, киевская, имеет свои корни в мировой, а минимум в европейской культуре, идеи добра, чести, свободы, справедливости, понимала эта Русь так, как понимал их весь западный мир. И есть вторая Русь, московская. Это Русь тайги, монгольская, дикая, звериная, и так далее, и так далее. То же самое, что вы сказали более-менее. This is very clear from our standpoint as well, from Georgia as well. But you spoke rather in optimistic terms to me about regime change and quite quick scenario, more or less, compared to long-term whatever it can be called, the new Zastoy or new nationalism, new reactionism in Moscow. How that can happen? What are the scenarios for this to happen? You think coup in the palace, or just substitution of Putin by another same kind of guy? I don't think he may be very okay with that, or sanctions and this isolation can play a decisive role, and critical mass can happen around it very soon. Well, what are the indications that you see? Because you have lots of contacts inside the system as well, I imagine. Do you really think that oligarchs can at some point be very decisive to make a decisive change there? Thank you.
Question of our Moscow poker from early morning till night. That's what we are discussing, which says a lot of unpleasant things about Russian intellectuals, experts, etc., within the liberal and all other oppositional ghetto. Because we should have thought about different things, about building a political alternative. Well, but how it could happen, I don't know. You never know. But there's only one possibility of the regime change under the severe impact of the crisis that is approaching. At the moment, we don't see that the Russia already is turning into the boiling kettle with closed lid. We don't see the signs. Only 35% in Moscow of Moscow respondents say that they will take to the street. Nobody knows how many people can do that. Nobody knows the degree of indignation and wrath and anger. You never know. Nobody could have predicted, you know, the last Ukrainian Maidan. Nobody knows it beforehand when tsunami is coming. We only know that this kind of demoralization, not anything else, not ideology, all right, there is no idea, but demoralization, lack of hope, frustration, total disorientation, you know, people feel that they've lost the sense, you know, the feeling of destiny. That never happened before, at least in my lifetime. After the collapse of the Soviet Union, we had much more hope, we were much more optimistic, we had much more drive, we had much more, maybe not brains, but heart. Today, demoralization is probably unique in our historical perspective. But at the same time, suddenly, out of the blue, 300,000 were on Bolotna Square and Sakharova in 2011. So it could happen. Just it was a drop of water because there was no real serious crisis. But when the crisis comes, I don't know what kind of tsunami, what kind of form it will take. The problem is that the most possible possibility and viability is that people around and within the Kremlin will take the drive, will, you know, put themselves into the driver's seat. But what they're going to do depends on the degree of anger and you know, the rest of the political establishment who could build the political alternative, not business. They're the most coward, okay? Not nationalists. Nationalists have no future in Russia. Nationalism is not a gluing idea because, well, otherwise it will split Russia. You know, we are very much afraid of ethnical Russian nationalism. So it should be something technocratic. What exactly? We don't have a glue. Anyone who gives you a scenario, he could be wrong because it's the area of imagination. But we are coming to the next stage. When it comes, we don't know.
Thank you.
I'm a PhD student from Tbilisi State University, Mikhail Shevtsova, and I want to comment about inevitability to avoid the war, August war. I think that it can be avoidable. For example, Baltic states also went to the NATO and the European Union, but Russia could not dare to do them anything. But I think it was because problem of democratic system, like democratic countries don't go war with each other. So it was two autocratic state which went head to head, and it was kind of that's why unavoidable. And Russia may be perceived when Saakashvili turned from democratically elected president as more to autocrat with less legitimacy, and it used this opportunity and did the same. For example, Russia could not do anything with Ukraine during the Orange Revolution because at that time country was consolidated and more democratic. So Russia used this opportunity when country becomes more autocratic.
So you think that Russia started this war to defend in Georgia democracy?
No, just two autocratic states are more likely to get it, with each other to war rather democratic countries. So both we are authoritarian more or less
okay.
States.
Thank you. So it was a comment. Let's take a question. And if you want, you can answer later.
No, I can't leave this without answer. No, no, really, because this is, excuse me, sir, but this is one of the most delusional statements I have ever heard in my life. War could be avoided. What the hell you are speaking about? Somebody was crazy enough to get oneself into war with Russia? Because, do you know what? We Georgians have a very, very nasty feature. When we discuss something, we do not have the slightest idea about. When you speak about Baltic geopolitics and etc., please, trust me, first finish the university. And read as much books as possible, and then come to conclusions. Even more so when it actually matters, and when it's about your own country, and when your statements are strengthening Russia's propaganda claims. I will explain to you why. Because in 1989, when Besmertnik was, you remember Besmertnik? No, you don't. Besmertnik was. The Minister for Foreign Affairs of the Soviet Union. Besmertnik got Schulz in Moscow. I already left the Ministry for Foreign Affairs of the Soviet Union, but I had more than enough friends there to know what the hell is going on. Schulz and Besmertnik, they took a decision. You do not touch three Baltic states, which incorporation of which we have never recognized. You can do whatever you want with the rest. This was the deal, which was cut. So when you are speaking about the war with Baltics, why one shall get into war with Baltics when you know that you first cut the deal and second, they're already there in NATO and the European Union. And the quicker you start the war, the quicker they will become the members of NATO and the European Union. And there was the second agreement during Yeltsin era when Primakov promised three no's. Do you know about this? No. Then stop making statements, please. Primakov promised three no's, no NATO bases in Baltics, no, three not promises, demands, no NATO bases in Baltics, no large-scale military exercises, no nuclear weapons. In the West, NATO said yes. So you speak about the West and Russia, not about Georgia. How we could the hell avoid the war when Russians were absolutely sure that...
I think regime makes easier for...
Excuse me, let me finish. You asked the question. It's a normal exchange of opinions. You ask the question, I answer. Then you ask again the question, okay? On September 4 of 2008, there was a ministerial of NATO scheduled. Moscow was 155% sure that we're going to get MEP. Now, I answered your questions. You can stay with your own opinion. I'm not arguing with you. I've just explained to you where your country was in 2008.
I'm Vashadze, Tbilisi, editor-in-chief of Georgian Journal Weekly Newspaper. So the question would be about Russian propaganda, and most probably, maybe you would be more eligible to answer that. The question would be that, yeah, absolutely, any of you, that would be interesting to hear. So the question is, Russian propaganda is shown, demonstrated quite sizable and impressive survival skills so far. Even in Western Europe, it's considered a significant minority opinion. There are the so-called Putin Versteers, Putin Understanders. And my question would be, what this understanding stems from? Because if you ask an ordinary Putin Versteher, I doubt he will say, well, Russia is doing very bad things in Ukraine, but we can't oppose that because we are getting resources from Russia, such as gas and oil. Thank you.
Maybe I will just start and Balázs will continue. There is absolutely amazing report on the propaganda and information war by Michael Weiss and Peter Pomerantsev. If you Google Michael Weiss and Peter Pomerantsev, there are all answers to any propaganda, information war, etc. Against Ukraine, Georgia, the West, etc. This is firstly. Secondly, the Russian propaganda machine has found absolutely elaborate and effective way of presenting its position, not through outrageous lie, but by raising the questions about the Western principles, by questioning the Western truth, by using half lies, etc., which appears to be much more by confusing the audience. Okay, so this is a different type of propaganda. But thirdly, I did 2 weeks lecture tour in Germany a month ago, 12 cities, well, different audience. And I was prepared, putting down all my arguments, talking to this Putin, let's understand Putin and let's understand Kremlin. Mm-hmm. I had only one guy in Hamburg who stood up and raised the question, belonging to the gang. I didn't find anyone, with the exception of German-Russian forum, who the guys are already, hiding in the corner. 68-70% of Germans do not trust Russia. This is total revolution in the German public
opinion. And 24 are actually not, can see the motivation behind Russia's action and are not exactly opposed to it. That's also part of the study.
But overall, the change is dramatic, so despite of the propaganda. Propaganda is working not in Germany. Propaganda is working, regrettably, in the UK, well, partially France and Belgium. Well, but I will give possibility to Balázs to respond.
Just very quickly, actually, I agree, and it's very important to say, because most of these concerns with the Russian propaganda is that these are lies, but this is not the reason why it's doing well. I consider the Russian propaganda actually quite weak when it comes to approaches, because it's really lying a lot and raising, it's bad journalism, really. There is actually another report, which it's not public yet, but the European Endowment for Democracies has been pulled together a major research on what is Russian propaganda, how it works, and what to do with it. It's going to be public release. It's 150 experts were engaged. This was essentially one of the main topics for the Riga Summit. They presented part of the research there. And I seen the main conclusions I was engaged in. And essentially, good journalism is the answer. Not anti-propaganda, which unfortunately you see a lot from Ukraine. In addressing the Russian propaganda, we do counter-propaganda. But good journalism. And last but not least, and I think this is the key thing, right? In many ways, the Russian propaganda is essentially using something which is out there in Europe, and that's a dissipating trust between citizens and the elites. And this has nothing to do with Russia. This has nothing to do with Putin. This is essentially because of our economic policies, because of the huge, the inequality growing, because of the youth unemployment in Western Europe, and because the convergence, which was the European Union, was essentially set up and accepted, is dissipating too. So unless Europe, you know, and obviously one of the reaction of the elites is blaming someone else, and here comes, you know, a bit hysterical reactions from the Western European elites toward the Russian propaganda on something the Russian propaganda is not really. You know, for Ukraine, it's a different story. When it comes to unemployment, that's not the fault of the Russian propaganda.
Thank you.
Მოგესალმებით, დიდი მადლობა დღევანდელი პრეზენტაციისთვის. მე ვარ ლელანა როუშვილი, ჟურნალისტი გრუზია ონლაინ. მაინტერესებს ესეთი შეიძლება მე ამიტური კითხვა იყოს, მაგრამ პასუხი მინდა ყველასგან, ყველასთვის არის ეს ჩემი კითხვა. რატომ ამბობენ, რატომ არის დამკვიდრებული დასავლეთში ამერიკა და დასავლეთის ქვეყნებში ესეთი თავის მართლების ესეთი ფორმა? Ჩვენ არ მოველოდით. Ეს იყო საქართველოს 2008 წლის ომის დროს. Ეს არის ახლა უკრაინასთან დაკავშირებით. ერთ-ერთმა გამომსვლელმაც თქვა, რომ ჩვენ არ მოველოდით. Ეს შეგნებულად ხმარობენ, რომ აიცილონ პასუხისმგებლობა თურისტვის. Და კიდევ თქვენი აზრით, მომავალშიც იქნება ეს აქტუალური და გამოყენებადი ეს პასუხი კონფლიქტებზე და ომებზე. Მადლობთ.
Why the West is bubbling, you know, that neither political establishment, as far as I understood the question, nor intellectual establishment was prepared, had been prepared for the war, for 2008 war, or for the war with Georgia, or for Ukrainian war? Anyway, for the war, okay? Well, my hunch, you know, I'm apparently in Moscow the most ardent and energetic pro-Western critic of the West. I love, you know, to attack the West. It seems to me lack of readiness of the Western political institutions, political class, and expert community, lack of their readiness for the war with Georgia in 2008, for the war between Russia and Ukraine in 2014, is the result of the fact that after the collapse of the Soviet Union, in fact, the West, as a community of liberal democracies, in fact, lost the competitor, lost the antagonizing force, lost some political establishment or power that forced liberal democracy to constantly be in the shade. You know, without competition, not a single system in the West can function normally. And the West has lost, you know, the trigger, the impetus, the hostile force that forced the West to constantly make perfection, lobotomy or makeup of itself, okay? And by the way, the West and Western politicians and all Western politicians after the collapse of the Soviet Union, they lost need for normative dimension in foreign policy and in policy in general. There is no enemy, there is no hostile civilization, there is no clash of civilization, no one to fight with, you know? No one to fight with. Why should I practice? Why should I practice and think about? So normative dimension was of politics, pragmatism, realism, and just, you know, schmoozing, boozing, dozing. By 2010, it was evident liberal democracies, all of them, are in crisis. The European Union, even now, is in paralysis. That's why Merkel is substituting the EU. There is no EU. There is, you know, a nice, beautiful Italian woman representing it, Mogherini, okay? There is no EU. What is America? There is no America with the American President Obama, okay? America has been retrenching from Europe and also kind of, you know, losing trajectory, which says that neither the state, nor a political force, nor a party, nor the society, nor liberal democracy, as the community of the system, cannot function without constantly having some threat from the outside. This is the truth. But thank God, and thank you, President Putin, he has a woke in the West. Yes, we all are paying price, but he has a woke in the West. They're still limping. They do not know how to fight and walk, but they got up from the bed, okay? And looking around, welcome the West.
Thank you, Lilia. It was very inspirational, so I can put together my own thought. Appreciate. I already mentioned that, but there is a degradation of the West as well going on. And for similar reasons why, you know, like for the similar factors which were leading the Ukrainian crisis into the Maidan, because, you know, what the Ukrainians are saying that they're fighting for the European Union, it's not really fully true. They're essentially having an internal crisis because, again, a fantastic inequality, particularly between the middle class and the elites, right? Which was essentially given by the oligarchic post-Soviet development. The second is the erosion or corrodation of traditional, in Ukraine, Soviet institutions, the collapse of the government. Third is the extreme rent-seeking and personal interest versus community or collective interest, which democracy should be about. The government represents the citizens' interest and work for the citizens' interest, not for individual interest. And four is the political polarization, which essentially leading toward gearing up a higher level of conflict. Now, if you're taking a look in the West, it's the same. The inequality is growing, the factors. The inequality is growing. The traditional government institutions, state institutions, are in crisis. And one of the reasons, you mentioned the Lehman Brothers, because the government takes the debt, what the private sector hoarded. You know, the bailing out of everyone else but the Lehman Brothers was a key thing. I am afraid the reforms were not done. What led to this situation? But it's a different story. So there is a crisis of traditional institutions, right? Four, there is rent-seeking and corruption. Essentially, the banking crisis and the bubbles are part of this rent-seeking, what the big private banks were doing. And fourth, there is growing political polarization. In the West, within the countries, and look at America, essentially the Congress is dysfunctional because of the very high political polarization, but also you see this political polarization in Western Europe or in the European Union, right? So we share part of these factors. The good news is that for us, for the West, these factors are less in share of what we've seen in Ukraine and what we're seeing Russia is going to, right? So, you know, So that's number one. Number two, you know, essentially the Ukrainian crisis is diverting the attention from the tremendous challenges Minister was talking about, and not only ISIS, which is essential for us here because it's in the neighborhood, but for the United States, it's containment of China, which has been the prime, you know, this pivot to Asia, which was a prime thing simply because of all these reasons, because, you know, the United States position as the main reserve currency in the world, and that manage that relationship, that containment is a key task for them. And, you know, essentially Russia, here comes Russia as a regional player, not a global player as the Russians would like to see, is important. It's not that key factor as Moscow would like to see, but still important if the Americans are serious to manage these challenges. But again, I'm working with Western governments for 10, 15 years in my life, and I can see this degradation of these institutions a lot. There are two very good books about that, which I recommend to read. One of them is Fukuyama, new book, and the second is the Harvard history professor book about the degradation of Western institutions. What came into my mind, I will tell, but I forgot which one. Thank you.
George Jelishvili, International Black Sea University and University of Georgia, Tbilisi. First of all, thank all three panelists for fascinating presentations and very good moderating, because it was really kind of everything was like thought-provoking and informative. So in the first place, actually the questions I addressed to all three panelists, but first I want to draw on the Professor Shevtsova's comment about West awakening up. So I personally so believe, maybe you might agree or disagree, it is so far only the United States which is sort of like waking up. It gives more hope that the next dweller in the White House will be more adequate, more like up to the challenge. So I believe that EU, with all its current problems with Greece, with Hungary, with kind of the southern flank, well, it's simply, well, has no room to address like more Syrian challenges, and which is actually energy dependencies. It will take time, and it, the West is awakening, but I think it is a serious time lag. The time lag will be longer in the eastern side of the Atlantic. As for the, and also after 2004, well, actually, everyone might challenge me or not, I believe that NATO largely outlived its usefulness. Several times NATO during these summits had trouble issuing the document because it was a disagreement between the members, and the Pew report revealed that is the very, very limited political willingness on the part of the societies in the NATO members to defend the Baltic states in case of serious trouble on the part of Russia. So I believe that only United States is the hope, and okay, we should all keep fingers crossed and hope the next dweller on the White House, hopefully it will be, again, in my opinion, not the neocon, but, well, internationalist Democrat like Hillary Clinton. So I think it will be the ideal choice. Again, you again might. I'm really surprised because I believe that most of Georgians I usually approach United States on the part of, like, the far right, and so disagree. I'm really surprised that you like this idea. Okay, thank you. So, thank you for this, for the praise. And second, so again, idea / question that I believe the small for small country to defend itself against kind of this bullish neighbor is to be relevant. So, if the country is relevant enough for the West can stand up. For instance, Germany didn't invade Switzerland during First World War, Second World War, because Switzerland had, there was two big Western stakes in this country. So, okay, potentially, kind of we are concentrating on the West, but speaking about the New World Order, we might even tangentially mention China and the, because China, India, kind of East Asia, the Asian poverty, it will be kind of new economic center of the West. Maybe if Georgia, say, develops ties with the West, with China, maybe Chinese investment like into Georgia would be a deterrent for Russia, because in the Russia-China partnership, Russia is a junior partner. Okay, thank you.
If I may, just very brief comment to your comment. Firstly, fully agree with your assessment of the United States, and I do believe that America has to return back to Europe because it's a new moment of truth, and America as the leading liberal democracy has to be in Europe. But I'm not sure that America is expected only in the capacity of the military hand, compensating the weakness of the European military budgets, like it did during the previous 50 years. I do believe that United States have to find another mission in Europe. But definitely, you know, America has to be a part of the, for instance, Normandy Forum. Well, make it Geneva Forum, okay? But secondly, absolutely amazing development is happening on the European scene. This is Germany. Germany becoming, by default, benevolent hegemon. Not wishing it, not wanting to do it, okay? But Germany is returning back, turning from political dwarf into a powerful force. And they don't know what to do with that, but Germany definitely has the future. And without Germany, EU would never, ever, you know, will get out of this retirement house. So Germany. And the third force, you know, don't forget Baltics plus Sweden plus some other, well, not big countries. You know, there can be a potential force, especially Poland, with a new government, with a new political force, not with the government of Ewa Kopacz, of course. But don't forget these small, you know, small countries, they could become a very powerful force if united. So in any case, thanks again to President Putin. He has changed the geography of the European Union and created, you know, a demand for America.
I've been living in the United States for 16 years, could be the American citizen, the American citizen right now. I simply couldn't stay at one place for more than 2 months. And I would have been voting Democrat all the time. And President Obama is leaving monumental economic achievements. Monumental economic achievements. We simply do not understand. We do not have journalism in this country, unfortunately, even less so foreign policy journalism. And we do not know, our Georgian society doesn't know what achievements present administration does have. And as a Georgian citizen, I would like to tell you sincerely and frankly, I would have Miss Hillary Clinton or any Democrat or Republican anytime as quick as possible, because she is not going to waste 2 years of understanding where Georgia is and what is Donbass, what you are eating it with. And all these provincial governors or senators, they are representing a huge danger for us right now.
Sheila, პირდაპირ არ ეხება ეს დღევანდელ თემას, მაგრამ მე მაინტერესებს. Ეხლა სომხეთში განვითარებული მოვლენები, უკრაინა, საქართველოს შეიძლება რომ აგრესია განხორციელდეს საქართველოზე რუსეთის მიერ. Არის ეს მოსალოდნელი?
Უკაცრავად. Სანამ უკრაინის საკითხი არ დამთავრდება, გამორიცხული არის, იმიტომ რუსეთს არც მატერიალური, არც პოლიტიკური, არც მორალური, არც სამხედრო რესურსები არ აქვს, რომ აგრესია წარმოოს ორი სუვერენული ქვეყნის ძალამ. Აი თუ რომ დამთავრდება, ეს სხვა საკითხი არის უკვე. I'll repeat this in English, so you are not wasting your time. As it is today, no. My explicit answer is no, until he finishes his Ukrainian adventure. After that, everything is possible, and I would say probable.
As a moderator, I would like to ask you all one final question. I would like to ask you about and interested in your prediction. World order. Today it's obvious that world can't be the same as it was even a year ago, and Ukraine-Russian relation can't be the same as it was even 1 year, 2 years ago. Georgian-Russian relation, the Europe can't be the same. And today it's the rethinking of the European defense policy, European security policy, even the NATO is in the process of assessment of his acting strategy. So how do you think the future of the world order in 5 years, in 10 years, because this process, we are still in the process, this process have to lead us to somewhere, yeah? So what is it? The spheres of influence, spheres of tension, spheres of new conflict, or spheres of cooperation and free competition? Your prediction.
Well, I think the major question here, and depends on various factors, but I see the most important ones, is number one is economic governance. I very much afraid that unless there is going to be correction of the current trends, what I mean is that all those money, printed money, is going to go back to the economy, which so far it's not really. But we see that unfortunately the current trends are going to continue, which is more political fragmentation, you know, more local solutions, therefore less influence of the global players or the regional players, more conflicts or crisis situations between major players. Yes, and what we see in Romania, right? For example, more middle class turbulence across the globe. At the same time, more available technology, right? Which also gonna kind of empower the protest and crisis movements, if you like. So I think we're gonna be more and more getting into fragmentation. At the same time, I cannot really foresee, these are more kind of local conflicts or local crisis situations than a global. situation, just as Ukraine is still localized, not isolated, but localized, and there's no resources, not that much resources available simply in state to go for a global war. Yet this is also a danger, because unless there is enough capacity, you know, there is going to be also a lot of miscalculation, which, you know, the reaction, I'm reacting on your reaction, you're reacting on my reaction, it's a downward spiral, which can lead into a to bigger conflict. Hopefully this is not the case.
Okay, your prediction.
Oh, well, I don't know, I'm so bad with predictions, but if we are talking about 2-3 years from now, I'm pretty sure that Russia will continue to be a key challenge for itself as a petronuclear power and for the outside world, and maybe the major challenge of the 21st century so far. Secondly, while this fact apparently will force the West to achieve some kind of unity, thirdly, Ukraine still will be trying to acquire the strong statehood. And fourth, a lot will be depending on how the China, rising China with a fake rise, will behave and how China will accommodate to this strange situation. It will be confrontation, hopefully, with some, you know, re-engagement on some geopolitical issues, but not much breakthrough. So disorder, hopefully light.
Tengo, thank you very much. I'm simply afraid to make any kind of predictions or prognosis, quite frankly, because to do so, you shall understand what's going to happen in a key countries, namely in the United States, in nearly six countries where we're going to, European countries where we're going to have general elections in 2016, again 2016 presidential elections in the United States, elections here in Georgia. So from the standpoint of citizen of Georgia, I'm very, very afraid to make any kind of prognosis. I would rather again repeat what we shall be doing right now, and to make this future a little bit better than, unfortunately, we down there do expect, you know. When we speak about Georgia, first of all, we shall understand that no individual Georgian or no political party will create a paradise for themselves, join separately NATO or the European Union, or build up a democratic, developed and liberal state for just themselves. We can do this only as a society. Thereby, we shall define some very clear national aim, purposes, and goals, and pursue them. And those goals are, it might sound surprising for me, but those goals are not right now about restoration of territorial integrity. We have been running after territorial integrity for 25 years, losing time and risking our population. If Georgians as a nation disappear because of hunger and poverty, what do we care about territorial integrity or democratic future? We shall start taking care of health, education, and well-being of our citizens. This is another question. Without massive, well-thought, well-understood, and well-executed government programs, it's absolutely impossible. I'll say one business will do everything by herself, himself, itself, is a clinical idiotism. Just think about it. If a law-abiding, tax-paying, decent businessman has a choice between importing 100,000 preservatives or planting 100,000 trees, what he is going to choose. So without government programs, we are not going to get out from this poverty abyss. That's what we shall be doing right now. And again, going back, I don't understand why we're scared to death to implement the whole AQ. What is the problem? We do not have economy, we do not have agriculture. What is the problem?
Абсолютно. У нас нет ни экономики, ни 53% of Georgians live in villages and produce 7% of GDP. Think about it. Latvians, they had to argue about agriculture because it's producing 25% of their GDP. What we are defending. So this is not a slogan here. No, this is just food for thought. And I would like to join everybody in thanking Lilia and Balázs for coming to Georgia. It's a privilege and honor. Thank you very much. And we had a fantastic moderator.
First of all, let me thank you. And let me thank to our distinguished speakers, because thank to you and your contribution. I hope everyone enjoyed today's discussion. And I would like to thank our organizers. Maya, thank you. Thank you, and I would like to thank the General Marshall Fund, and I hope you will support into the future such discussion. And I would like to thank our translators, and I would like to thank our distinguished audience. Thank you.